ladies and gentlemen, Archbishop Fulton J. Sheen.
I have traveled much around the world, and I have met many remarkable men. I judge characters in two ways. One, not by what they have, but by what they are. And second, by their willingness to suffer for a noble cause. Given those two standards, I am very happy to be here with a man who has been very much influenced my life, Pastor Wormbrand.
God bless you.
Pastor Wormbrand has spent 14 years in a communist prison. He was 3 years in a pit 30 feet deep. And all this because he preached Christ in season and out of season. I'm now going to turn to this very wonderful Christian to ask him to tell us something about his life.
I started my life as a very poor orphan child. In my childhood, I had never heard neither the name of Christ nor that of God. I'm Jewish, but Jewish by race. I had never been brought up in the Jewish religion. And after a very bitter childhood, at the age of 14, I was already a very convinced atheist. I was sure that there is no God. I can understand those who say that God is dead. This is an expression of a deep disappointment. I was sad about the fact that there is no God. I would have liked a God to be. I would have liked that somewhere in the center of this universe there should beat a heart with love for me. I have not been kissed much. I have not been caressed. I have not heard many good words when I was a child. I have eaten my whole childhood one cake and a half. The one has been stolen. And so, though a very convinced atheist, I went from church to church, of all denominations I didn't even know what they are, and I tried to find out something about this God. I remember I was in a Catholic church. I saw people kneeling before the statue of a beautiful lady. I didn't know who this lady is. And they said something. And I said, I will catch their words. And I will say after them. And they said the rosary, so I said after them. And I expected that something will happen. Nothing happened. And so in Protestant churches, in Orthodox churches, in synagogues too. And to cut a long story short, I arrived to despair, and one day I said the prayer of an atheist, God, I know for sure that you don't exist, but if perchance you exist, which I contest, I speak in madness to a non-existing, if you exist, it is not my duty to believe in you, it is your duty to reveal yourself to me. This prayer was accepted. Who can limit the goodness of God? He accepts just everything, I believe. I found out later that just at that time, higher up in the mountains in Romania, a carpenter who had never seen me had prayed to God like this, God, I have served thee on earth, and I wish to have my reward on earth, not in heaven. And my reward should be that I should not die before I bring a Jew to Christ, because you, Jesus, are from the Jewish people. Bring a Jew into my village. There are no Jews here. And I was the first Jew to come into that village. He was a simple man, he could not tell me much, but he gave me the New Testament to read. I could not read it, I could only weep over it, comparing always my life with the life of Jesus. He always pure, I unpure. He honest, I dishonest. He truthful, I a liar. I regretted my life, but I also found that there exists forgiveness and salvation through him. I became a Christian and afterwards a pastor, but in very difficult times, in Nazi times. Many of my family have been killed. I have been in Nazi prisons. My wife has also been court-martialed by them. And then the communists took over my homeland, Romania. They started a very heavy persecution of Christians. All Catholic bishops, innumerable priests, monks, nuns went to prison, Orthodox bishops, pastors, Protestants, and then tens of thousands of laymen, farmers, young boys, young girls, whosoever witnessed for Christ had to go to prison. I was one of the organizers of the underground church in Romania. I could work underground during 3 years and a half, as well among the Soviet soldiers who had occupied my homeland, as among the Romanian population. But in the end, every thief is caught once. And so I also was caught, and I had to go to prison. The first years we were kept, everyone alone in a cell, 30 feet beneath the earth. During years we never saw sun, moon, snow, flowers, stars. We never had a book. We never had a bit of paper. We were meant just to look to the gray walls of the cell. Sometimes the punishment was that you had no gray walls. You were put in a cell with black walls. And the wardens were dressed in black. You can't imagine what it means to have always black around you. But there I could experience the truth of the Bible. Sometimes the walls of the cells shone like diamonds. There was so much light in it. There was so much joy. Jesus and his holy angels have been with us. I had always liked to sing the praises of the Lord, accompanied by organ, by piano. We didn't have these in prison. But happily they had put chains at our hands and at our feet, and so we could sing, "Onwards Christian soldiers, cling, clang, cling, clang, marching as to war, cling, clang, cling, clang." And there exists this joy of Christ, which does not depend upon external circumstances. There exists a reality beyond what our senses perceive. We have arrived to this reality, and I can witness for me and for the others who have been in prison, after the first years we were in common cells, that you can have joy amidst tribulations and sorrows. And the first good news which I can give to you, all my listeners, I know that there are sufferings in America too. You have your part of sorrows. When the outlook is very bad, try the uplook. Look to Christ, and he will give you comfort amidst of sorrows. There are around 1 million Christians in communist jails today. They are tortured. Many of them have been killed. Children are taken away from their parents. Christians are sometimes in psychiatric asylums. We have now brethren who are in straitjackets and gagged because they believe in Christ. The Jews are persecuted, the Muslims, so many innocents. But there exists a comfort in God. God is a reality. We have experienced his presence, and he gave us joy and can give it to you too.
Mr. Wormbrand, I can understand very well what you say, because after all, the Christian law is, unless there's a Good Friday in our lives, there will never be an Easter Sunday. Unless there is the cross, there will never be the empty tomb. And you've passed through that suffering, and you passed through it because you knew that our blessed Lord passed through it and triumphed. But now looking back on it, there's a question that I should like to ask you with some reference to America. There is a growing influence of the demonic in American life today. Our youth does not know how evil it is, that it is personal, it is from hell. And I am sure, inasmuch as you have spent 14 years in the prison, that you have had, out of your love for Christ, some experience of the demonic. Would you please tell us?
First of all, I must tell you that 14 years of prison was not much. We had forgotten the Bible in prison. because we were doped with drugs which would destroy our mind. But on the day when I fulfilled 14 years of prison, out of oblivion came just one Bible verse. I did not know what precedes, neither what follows. And the verse which came was that Jacob, I didn't know who Jacob was, that Jacob worked for Rachel 14 years, and it seemed for him a little time because he loved, and we also loved Jesus, so it was not too much. Now, I'm very happy that you put this question to me. There is something which is usually not known about communism, that Marx was a member of the secret Satanist church in London. There exists a book which Marxists hide, but which is written by Marx. It is called Ulanem. Ulanem is an anagram of the holy name Immanuel, God is with us, the name of Jesus. Ulanem is used in black magic. And Marx has written at the age of 24 these very words: I have sold my shirt to the prince of darkness, and my aim is to draw the whole humanity in the abyss, in the hell, and to go after it, and there to laugh about how I succeeded, and to hold curses upon God. That is Marx. He did not care about socialism, about proletariat, about a better state of humanity. That is what he wished. And Moses Hess, the one who brought him to socialist convictions, after having met Marx, says, I have found the man who will draw God down from heaven. That is what Marxism is about. I have known myself a communist torturer. I have heard him saying, I thank God, in whose existence I don't believe, that he has made us to live such a beautiful time in which you can do the most wicked things and be rewarded for them. So there exists something satanic, and in solitary cells we felt the nearness of Satan. We had not the slightest doubt that he is there, as I would feel the nearness of a man near me. And he tempted us to deny Christ, to get our liberty by betraying our brethren and so on. And it is not so that only sins and temptations lure you in America. There exists surely such things, but there exists a personal power. The Bible is true. I believe every word of the Bible because I have seen men saved through the words of the Bible. I have seen also men damned because they refused to receive the words of the Bible and going from bad towards the worse. There exist these demonic influences in the United States. In communist countries, they have triumphed. It is the triumph of the Antichrist. When I started the underground church, I have been one of its organizers in Romania. We had all hell unleashed against us. But in the end, the devil is a very little thing in comparison with Christ. In the book of Revelation, it is written that Christ will destroy him just by the breath of his mouth. That's all. And we should know about the devil, we should know about hell, we should know about the demonic, but we should never be afraid, as your grace has rightly said. Christ has felt all the fury of hell launched against him on Good Friday, but he knew the resurrection too. We have known the fury of hell. In communist prisons in Romania happened the same thing which happened in Russia and which Solzhenitsyn describes now, the Nobel Prize winner. Christians have been compelled to eat their feces and to drink urine. They were tied to crosses 4 days, 4 nights. The crosses were put on the floor every night, and other prisoners were tortured to fulfill their bodily necessities upon the faces and the bodies of the saints of God. And then the communists stood around mocking, look how beautiful your Christ is and for what fragrances he brings from heaven. They drove a priest to madness to say Holy Communion, the words of Holy Communion upon this dirt, and so on. Terrible things have happened. Terrible things happen today in communist countries. all the churches of Red China have been closed and desecrated with posters on which it is written, "Hang God." And over 1 million Christians were killed under tortures. In Russia, 9/10 of the churches have been closed. Priests, pastors, simple laymen of all denominations have been and are in prison. From the Christian Khmara, they have torn his tongue out. We have his picture. The young Christian Ivan Moiseev, at the age of 20, they stabbed him 6 times in the region of his heart. Brother Khrapov has made 31 years of prison. Brother Borislav, 25 years in a psychiatric asylums. These men must be helped. Christian charity will overcome the demonic in the United States and behind the curtain.
We're talking with Pastor Wurmbrand about his experiences in communist prisons, and I would like to know now just a little more about what Christians in general are doing. Are they really helping you as much as they should?
Well, there are so many good causes, many more good causes where you should help than the possibilities to help. We have spoken to Christians in America, Protestants and Catholics and Orthodox and Baptists and so on. The saints of God, the children of God, were moved to tears when they heard that there are now Christian mothers in Russia who don't have their children. From the family Malozemlov, the communists have taken away 7 children. Just imagine how it is for a mother when a van of the secret police stops before her house and her children are torn out.
Somehow or other, Pastor Wurmbrand, since I have known you, I have discovered that you have many, many communications behind the Iron Curtain and also in China.
Yeah.
Isn't that true? You need not reveal those communications, but you can verify that.
Yeah. We communicate with the European communist countries. We communicate relatively easily. The communists, being greedy to get dollars, encourage very much tourism. And last year, the Soviet Union and the European satellite countries had 4.5 million tourists. Now, when you have 4.5 million tourists, you can't check the tire of every car to see what is in the tire. You can't check every car to see if it doesn't have a double bottom. And sometimes they would check if it doesn't have a double bottom, which should be filled with gospels, and they find it has no double bottom. But the gospels were in the double roof of the car. When you have 4.5 million tourists, you can't check every pregnant woman to find out if she has in her womb a boy, a girl, or perhaps there are gospels in the womb. And they themselves have made us repeatedly in the communist newspapers a compliment that these men of Wurmbrand are as refined contrabandists as the greatest contrabandists of the world. So we use all kind of means to smuggle into communist countries the word of God, after which they are unspeakably hungry. Secondly, we broadcast the gospel in different languages of communist countries. We use the sea waves. We have studied the ocean currents, and we wrap some Christian booklet or a gospel in a plastic bag. We put a straw on it so that it should float, and the waves bring it to the shores of Red China or North Korea or Russia or Albania or so on. And then we consider that we have one duty of honor more. Around 1 million Christians are in jails. What do their children eat? While my wife and I were in jail, my son has hunger. And there are now many, many hundreds of thousands of Christian children who hunger because their parents are faithful to Christ. It is simply unlawful that the situation should continue. And through books like this, Tortured for Christ, I've written many other books also, through the newsletters which we issue monthly, and then through speeches in rallies or in churches, I tell Christians about this situation. And I must say that Russia or Romania or China don't have the monopoly of saints. You can be a well-to-do American and be a saint also. God looks to the heart. You must not be in a prison in order to be a saint. There are some in America, they are free. but they love Christ so much that if ever persecution would come, they would be ready to die for him. And these saints respond, we are very thankful to this, and our couriers go continually and bring this help into communist countries as well, help for the families of Christian martyrs, as books and Bibles and so on.
This is one of the things that first inspired me to help you, was the fact that you suffered, and therefore any work that you do now has no self in it. It is wholly for other people. Now remember, the very first offering that I ever gave to you was to help drop Bibles off ships in order that they might float into Russia. Mm-hmm. And I'm still helping you, and I will help you, and I hope other people help you too, Dr. Wernbrand.
Well, they float continually, and we are very thankful to all those who make this possible. I must tell you, I am very moved when our couriers come back from there. They go with the intention to comfort those who suffer. They come comforted from there, and they say that families of martyrs sometimes plead, send us less money. Don't care about our food. Send us rather the word of God. But we know that our duty is to do both. The children of Christian martyrs should not go hungry. And the couriers come back and tell us such examples of heroism there. Christians, they go to death. There are 5 or 6 cases of death sentence which we know and we can document from the Soviet press. They receive death sentence with shining faces. And there are cases of young communists who tear down their red neckties, which are their signs of recognition, and confess Christ publicly in baptism. The underground church and our mission do not work in vain. We have won for Christ Svetlana Stalina, the daughter of the greatest mass murderer of Christians. It's quite an achievement of the underground church. The underground church has won for Christ the 2 great Nobel Prize winners of Russia, Pasternak and Solzhenitsyn. Russia is the only country which forbids the works of its Nobel Prize winners because they confess Christ and so many others. The underground church suffers, but the blood of martyrs has always been the seed of the church. And if American Christians have so many blessings, they should know from where these blessings come. I have seen myself in communist prisons, Christians with 50 pound chains at their feet, praying every night for America, for its churches, and for its children. That is where your blessings come from. Don't forget to pray for them.
Well, Pastor Wernbrand, I trust that the American people now will be interested in your cause as I am interested. I can remember reading. No, you told me once about 2 children that were taken from the mother, and they left saying, "Don't worry, Mother, we will keep our faith." And I'm sure that American Christians now will be willing to support you as I am. In fact, I owe you a great debt for the inspiration that you've given me. And America owes you a debt, and the good Lord is pleased with you.
May God bless you, dear Archbishop.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Wernbrand.
Thank you for viewing this television special. For your personal copy of the book, Tortured for Christ, write today to Voice of the Martyrs, Box 11, Glendale, California. The address again is Voice of the Martyrs, Box 11, Glendale, California.